In this lecture, we're going to look at a physical application of the cross product, which is calculating the torque due to a force acting on an object like a wrench or sink faucet. So imagine that this is like a handle and it has a pivot point right here. I want to model the handle as going out from the point that it rotates around. Now imagine I take my hand or something like that and I push on the handle, causing it to turn. Torque is essentially a way of measuring that turning effect caused by the application of force to this lever or this faucet. Torque is defined as a cross product. It's the cross product of this position vector going out from the pivot. So that's like the vector modeling the wrench or whatever it is that we're turning. So we take that vector and we cross it with the force which is being applied. The cross product of two vectors produces another vector, although what we're often interested in with torque problems is just the magnitude. So using that property that the magnitude of a cross product can be written as the product of the magnitudes of the vectors times sine of the angle that they open up, the magnitude of the torque is the magnitude of the vector that represents the object being turned times the magnitude of the force times the angle that they open up. Both of these are vector magnitudes, but I think it helps in the context of these problems to treat them a little bit differently. So when we say the magnitude of R, what we're usually talking about is yes, a magnitude, a length, but really, literally a length. How long is this object? So it could be 0.3 meters long. On the other hand, the length of F should be treated as a magnitude of force measured in newtons. So those are both vector magnitudes, but physically you want to think about them a little bit differently. So overall, the unit here is newton meter. We could go on and do problems, but I want to talk a little bit more about this because we just learned about the cross product. So in particular, let's take this force vector and orthogonally decompose it with respect to this vector R modeling the object being turned. So if I do that, I can break the force vector into a parallel component, which is parallel to the object being turned, and a perpendicular component. Which one causes the object to be turned? The answer is the perpendicular component. If I apply a force that just points parallel to the sink faucet, it's not going to turn the sink faucet. But if you come in directly 90 degrees, you are going to turn that faucet. So only the perpendicular component should cause this object to rotate. Let's see if that makes sense given that torque is defined as a cross product. So we would like to see this property that only the perpendicular component causes rotation. It is going to agree with the cross product, and the reason why is that if the torque vector is R cross F, and then I take F and decompose it and do F parallel plus F perpendicular, cross product is distributive, so that's going to be R cross F parallel plus R cross F perpendicular. But the cross product of parallel vectors is the zero vector, so we pick up nothing from this first term. So R cross F is exactly the same as R cross F perpendicular. The parallel component did not cause any rotation. Let's find the magnitude of the torque about the screw. So in other words, I'm applying a force kind of at an angle here. The magnitude of the force I'm applying is 20 newtons. What is the rotation like? How much torque is being applied? Okay, this, I don't know what I've drawn a picture of. It's something holding onto a screw. I don't know, I made this up. But the length of this thing that we're turning is 0.1 meters. Our force is 20 newtons. Then we need sine of the angle between them. Now you might think that's just sine of 110 degrees and it will actually give you the right answer, but I want to be a little bit precise here. Just because, especially in this first unit, I think it's really important to always treat vectors carefully. Our position vector for the rotation happening here starts at where we're turning and goes out. We're saying that that should be 0.1 meters. So if I want to look at the angle that the vector R and the vector F are opening up, normally I would draw the tails of those vectors as coming out of the same point. So if I do that, the angle that they're opening up is 70 degrees. The supplement of that angle is 110 degrees. So we can say that the magnitude of torque is the magnitude of R times the magnitude of F times sine of the angle between them. But really, we want to think of that as the length of the object being rotated, which is 0.1 meters, times the magnitude of force, which is 20 newtons, times sine of the angle between them, which I'm going to say is sine of 70 degrees. And when you crunch those numbers, you get about 1.88 newton meters. Now, what would have happened if you did sine of 110 instead of sine of 70? Nothing, because supplementary angles have the same sine. But always, when you're modeling something with vectors, I do think it's important to understand where the tails of the vectors are located, where the heads of the vectors are located. So the tail of R is located here, the head of R is located there. So technically, the angle opened up by the R and F vectors is 70 degrees. Let's look at this example. We have some wagon wheel, and I don't know, you and your roommate are both trying to turn it, but in opposite directions. So person A is applying a force of 20 newtons at an angle of 30 degrees as drawn in this picture, whereas person B is applying a force of 10 newtons at an angle that makes 45 degrees with the horizontal drawn in this picture. Which way is this wheel going to turn? We can rephrase that question as, which is greater, the torque from A or the torque from B? Whichever one has the greater turning effect is going to win. So we're just going to compute the magnitude of these torques. At A, so we're pivoting around the center of this wheel. So it's the length of the position from that pivot out to where the force is being applied. So that's the length of R times the magnitude of the force times sine of 30 degrees. I didn't actually give you the radius because it's not going to matter. So whatever the radius is, times 20 newtons times sine of 30 is 1/2. So the magnitude of the torque due to the force being applied by person A is 10 times the radius of the wheel. On the other hand, what's happening over at B? The radius is the same. So that's our position from the center of the wheel out to the edge of the wheel where the force is being applied. This force, though, is 10 newtons. And sine of 45 degrees is square root of 2 over 2. You crunch that, you get 5 times the square root of 2 times the radius. Square root of 2 is 1.7 something, so 5 times the square root of 2 is not going to get us all the way up to 10. That means that the turning effect from person A is greater than the turning effect from person B. So this wheel is going to turn clockwise. Okay, that concludes our lesson on torque. Thank you for your attention.